already got quiet, so I'm gonna have to do that. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the regular scheduled council meeting for Tuesday, February 21st, 2017, at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier, how are you? Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsey?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Crable?
Here.
Welcome back, John.
Thank you.
Five, six members present.
Thank you, sir.
All right, move on. We'll have tonight's invocation by Jeff Christmas from First Baptist Church.
Would you bow with me for prayer? Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you once again, asking for your grace and your mercy, and asking you for wisdom as our city conducts its business. We pray that you would also lend your protection to our first responders, and Father, give us the courage to do the things that we're called upon to do. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. And we'll do the pledge tonight. We'll use the flag and the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we move on, if any of you guys have cell phones tonight, do me a favor, just turn it down, please. I appreciate that. Moving on to action on minutes for the regular scheduled council meeting of February 6, 2017.
Mr. Mayor, so moved.
Second.
Got a motion by Mr. Lindsey, a second by Mr. Reynolds. Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Krabach?
Abstain.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Minutes passed 5-0-1. Sir, moving on, no communications tonight, so we'll go down to Mr. Bridge, City Manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of public. Great, awesome to see a bunch of students here at the full house, so open up the minds and learn a little bit while you're here. I would like to share with you a little bit about the City Manager's report. We'll jump to the finance discussion with our finance director, Ms. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, and members of the public. The finance report is for January. Our total revenue we collected was $186,285.21. Total expenditures for the month of January was $349,953.09. We are working on our temporary budget. Let's see, what else? The income tax collected will be receipted in next month's report. Since we have switched over to our outsourcing with CCA, they have collected approximately $109,000 for us, but it will be in next month's in the total. So I don't have too much, but other than that, it's a very short report. Welcome any questions anybody has.
I just had one, Ms. Harris. How is the tax collection going as far as calls from citizens and people stopping by?
We are getting a few positives that the website is easy to use, and we're getting some requests for help. So Ms. Taylor, our tax administrator, has made appointments for people so that she's available to help them walk through doing the forms for the first time. Anybody that walks in, we have a sample on our wall. They've been taking a picture with their phone, so they kind of can look at how to fill it out. So it's been receptive, and again, we'll have other times set up to where we'll be able to meet with anybody and assist them this year in doing their forms.
Great, thank you.
Just really fast here, Ms. Harris, I don't know if it's for you or for Chief Trustee, but do you know how long until the fire truck is paid off? I'll just look at the month. 4 years?
We refinanced for five, so
5 years. We're in the first year, the fifth year.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Craybacher?
I guess two things. This notice that you have in the packet, the income tax notice, is that the same notice that went out to the
correct
to everybody? Okay. Number two, and you might not be able to answer this, and this might be different. Does everybody that earns income, do they have to file income tax, no matter what their age is?
There is an age limit. I don't have my guideline with me.
The reason I ask is since there's a lot of teenagers here, sure. And summer help. And
let me see if I can come up with that answer before the end of the
okay.
Council.
I might be able to answer that if you don't mind. Any income that a minor would make, regardless of age, they'd have to file the city income tax. And the reason you'd want to do that is because if you're under 18 years old, you will get that money back. If you don't file to receive that money back, then the city keeps it. So that would be the only reason a minor, somebody under 18, would file. Same way through federal and state, because they're taking all that money out. And as a minor, you will get all that money back, whatever that amount is. Regardless of age.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Right. Thank you, Ms. Harris, for appreciating it.
And moving on with the city manager's report, our service discussion with our service director, Mr. Chico.
Thank you, Mr. Fridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. I just have two quick items to update everyone on. I'm currently working with engineers on our various road projects, i.e. Prentice, and then really an unnamed couple streets that we're trying to look at on which ones we want to do for our in-house levy work. Item number two, because of the very mild winter we have been having, my street crews have been able to currently remove a number of dead trees throughout the city right away, including Willowick Park, so we've got a lot of work done that normally we would have had to wait till spring to get completed. That is all I have for now. I can entertain any questions on any topic.
Thank you, Mr. Kirschbacher.
Down by Water Dog, you know, I know we have always had that problem. You know, somebody's told me that that's been tore up again and the hole's ready to swallow tires. Is there anything you can do to patch it or anything?
We're patching it as the holes become, as they start right now, but this spring or early summer, we will be cutting that area out and do a full base rehab in that area.
What does that mean when you say cut it out?
We will basically saw cut to the dirt underneath the concrete and completely remove everything there and rebuild that area. And that'll be coming out of like our state highway funds. That won't come out of our street levy funds or anything like that.
Okay, thank you.
What you just mentioned, wasn't that done just a couple years ago? Complete reconstruction?
I'm sorry, say it again?
Wasn't that just done a couple of years ago, complete reconstruction right there in that area?
We did a couple small little holes, okay. But it was only down to the surface of the concrete. We're actually going to take the base concrete out too, because I think that's what's leading to this problem.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Kitko, also, I've noticed a couple of places where water mains have been repaired lately. You guys can't properly fix those, right, until the weather's...
Until the asphalt plants get opened back up.
Okay, that's all I thought. Thank you.
But if there are any that need attention, we do keep putting gravel or 304s in the meantime.
Mr. Mayor. Mr. Kitko, when does the plants open back up for the blacktop?
Usually middle to end of April.
Okay, thank you.
Depending on the weather. We've had good weather, so maybe a little earlier.
Yeah, but it's supposed to snow this weekend, I hear, so.
Thank you, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you. And moving on with the City Manager Report, our fire discussion with Chief Trusty.
Thank you, City Manager. Mayor, Councilman, Public. The Fire Division for the month of January, New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 90 EMS calls in the city, 5 EMS calls in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 5 fire-related calls in the city and 4 in Elizabeth Township. We had 5 EMS calls answered by mutual aid either by Piketown, Chippewa, Beth, or Clark due to our medic already being on a response. Out of the EMS calls for the month, we had 5 overdoses. One of those was a DOA. We answered 4 mutual aid responses to either Bethel Park or to Pike Township. Medic 52A was able to respond 3 times. That's getting our backup medic out the door. On the EMS side, Assistant Chief Geiselman taught 2 CPR classes this month for a total of 8 people at no cost to them. On the fire side, this is something new for us that hasn't happened in a long time. We've had an instructor that teaches for Clark State Fire ask the division to host a level 2 fire course, which is the second phase of a firefighter certificate. He's asked the fire division to host a course in New Carlisle, and it'll be at no cost to the division other than letting them use our training room and using the old Madison School for some training exercises. What it does give us, though, is allows us to send one person from the division through the course at no charge. So that's a big plus for us. Other than that, good news is our raising money for the Lucas tool. We opened the account Thursday after the last meeting. Monday morning, we were able to close the account. The money was there. So we'll be able to purchase the Lucas tool this month.
Good news. Mr. Lindsay. Chief, you said you had 5 calls answered, EMS calls answered by mutual aid. Do we not have the people now to get our second medic out, or was it already out?
It all falls in whatever the time frame. A lot of our people that are in the city also work other jobs, or they also work 24/48 at either private ambulance services or another fire department. Mm-hmm. It all depends on when it falls, that time, if they're available or if they're not available. And that's just luck of the draw, basically.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
I just want to thank you, Chief, for adding into our reports about the overdoses that have happened in New Carlisle. People, obviously this epidemic is horrible. There was an opioid summit last week in Columbus where 1,500 people attended, and they asked how many people would you know, or someone you know, or in your family has overdosed. And I would say about 90% of the hands went up. It's no longer just a inner city drug. It's no longer a white collar drug. It is a drug that will affect everyone, no matter race, sex, orientation, any of that, religion. It affects everybody, so thank you.
And to show you the how bad it's getting, that was for January. We had 5 and 1 DOA. As of today, which is the 21st, we've had 9 this month with 1 DOA.
I hate hearing that because it has hit home with my family. So, anyway, on page 2, you have this chart, and I was trying to make something of the chart, but it shows a line almost going straight up from 122.17 to 128. And usually that means that there's a discrepancy there. Does that chart mean, can you explain the chart to me? Maybe I'm misunderstanding. See what I'm talking about? There's a big fluctuation.
Which chart are you looking at, sir?
This one right here.
Call volume chart.
Oh, the call volume?
Yeah, there's a big line that's going straight up. And usually,
that just means that was the peak time of the month for runs.
Peak time of the
month. That's for fire response.
Is that normal, like at the end of the month like that, or is that
this all depends on what happens. We've run a lot more brush fires in the past couple months.
Brush fires?
Grass fires, brush fires. And when you're looking at our fire responses, you have to understand we're also not only responding in the city, but that could be a response to Pike Township, that could be a response to Bethel Park, it could be a response to Bethel, Miami, or it could be a response to Elizabeth Township.
Okay.
It's like I said, it just all depends on when things happen. If you look at our stats for 2015, our busiest day of the week was Tuesday in the afternoon. It just all depends on when things happen.
That's just my brain's thinking.
But like I said, right now we are running a lot more brush fire calls, people burning off brush and getting out of hand, and you know, people flipping a cigarette out the window, of course, those type of brush fire calls.
Yeah, I just, you know, I want to make that clear. You know, like you said, throwing cigarettes out the window, I have seen people do that. And I've always wondered if things around there are just too dry.
Oh, yeah.
Just too dry. And it
right now is a prime time. And we ran in the past week or past week, we ran 5 brush fires.
Yeah, wow. So that's on the outside, naturally, outside the city?
Most of them, yeah. Most of them are either Pike Township or Bethel Park or Elizabeth Township.
Okay, thank you.
One more question, Chief. Mr. Wright?
Just real fast, with Narcan, I was wondering just quickly if you have his number. Do you know how much it costs roughly?
For us, it doesn't cost anything.
Okay, that was my next question would be, if it does, do we get reimbursed for that?
What, our,
all right, thank you.
Our Narcan comes from the Miami Valley Drug Bag Program. We carry 4 Narcan doses in our drug bag. Anytime that's used, we just basically, we will go to the hospital and swap out that drug bag for a new one. Now, we do carry 1 dose of Narcan on our battalion vehicle.
Okay.
And if we was to use that one, we would replace that one. And it costs right around $40 a dose, $40 to $50 a dose.
How much Narcan does it typically take to resuscitate someone?
It's hard to tell.
It builds resistance if you keep... Okay.
It's not only the building up the resistance, but it's also what they're taking. How much has it been cut with fentanyl? If it's a large amount of fentanyl, it's going to take a larger amount of Narcan. This time last year, on the average, we were Narcaning a patient. One to two hits of Narcan to bring them back. Right now, we're running anywhere from 4 to 6. Last week, we had one patient that took 10.
Ooh. So are we paying for that extra... out of pocket for the extra 6?
No. What happens is we'll deplete our drug bag. Deputies are on scene. Each deputy carries 2 in their first aid pouch that they have. They'll give us theirs, or we just Narcan, use what we've got, and then the next best drug is fuel. Get them to the hospital as quick as we can.
All right. Thank you. That's all the questions I have.
Chief, I just had one. We were talking before the meeting. When you take someone that's OD and you take them to the hospital, you've already saved them, you brought them back. What's the hospital's role once they come back?
That's up to the patient. The patient can go into the hospital and take the treatment and ask to go to rehab or whatever, or the patient can get off of our gurney onto their bed and sign the refusal paper and walk out the door.
And there's no way, if we're administrating Narcan, that we cannot force them to go to the hospital once we've used
Once we've Narcan them and they're conscious and they're orientated to where they can tell us person time, we cannot force them to go to the hospital. If we do, then it's considered kidnapping. Now the deputies, now that they can charge them, which they do, our deputies work very, very well with us, hand in hand on overdose patients. They support us a great deal in talking to patients. Look, you need to go to the hospital. Now, if we already put the patient in the back of the medic and we're on the way to the hospital, give them Narcan, they ain't got a choice.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Questions?
Mr. Wesley.
Chief, have you heard about, the marijuana being laced with fentanyl now? And it's a different strand or whatever the word would be for fentanyl that they take a couple of hits from their joint and can kill them.
Yeah. Everybody that thinks that any drug, it's just this, it's just that. When you're buying it off the street, you're not getting a drug that's not been prescribed for you. You don't know what it's laced with. Ride with us for one shift and see some of the things that my paramedics see on a daily basis, and I guarantee you won't touch it.
Do you have a program within the department for observers from the community?
They can do a ride-along program, yes.
They can do a ride-along?
They sign a waiver to ride along with us.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chief. Appreciate your report.
And moving on to the city manager report, our police discussion with Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you, city manager, mayor, council, and citizens. And our January report, before I get started with it, a lot of people don't know this. Narcan wears off. Mm-hmm. And when it does, you could subject yourself right back to where you were. You just about did. And it is like a miracle drug. I first couple times I witnessed it, I couldn't believe the effects of it. You're looking at basically a person with so weak a pulse, you think they might be dead, and the next thing you're looking and they're standing up talking to you. But if that wears off, they could actually end up dying.
It's a throwaway drug.
Yeah.
Well, what's known as a throwaway drug, it lasts about 15 minutes.
So that's why we want to get you to the hospital. In December, the Clark County Sheriff's Office started using a program called Emergitech, Intercad. And Intercad's a new system for dispatching. and Intertech Interbadge, and I was confused for a month about it, is in the patrol cars. This new system provides more information to dispatch by listing all EMS and sheriff department calls on the screen. Now, up until the first of the year, we didn't know where the EMS was going. They would dispatch us, but we couldn't see. Now we can tell where they're going. And this information is transmitted to patrol car computers, and both dispatch and the deputy and the deputies are looking at the same screen. Now, there is two different screens, but both the deputies and dispatch are familiar with both screens. One is just minimized a little bit. Then each view calls that deputies are on and what calls are holding. So I can tell if the guy working out in Northridge, I can tell if he's backed up on calls or what's going on, and they can see what's going on up here in New Carlisle. You can actually look and say, wow, they're backed up like five calls. The theory of all this is hopefully somebody will pick up the phone and say, hey, if there's any phone reports, maybe I can help you with them. Because our priority is to cut the calls down. That hasn't happened much, but hopefully we'll get more into that. And with all this being done on our new in-car computers, radio traffic is kept to a minimum. And not all the computers are new. And New Carlisle's computers are paid for and serviced by the Clark County commissioners. And I want to, boy, that's a benefit that I just can't believe they give us. But it's new. We're still going through some pain with it. We've been doing reports the same for many years, and now all of a sudden we're changing it. And then also for us, in January, Mother Nature was kind to us with the weather, and that was leaving New Carlisle with 3 non-injury crashes and only 1 injury crash. And that's amazing in January, to be honest with you. The common factor, all 4 crashes, they're on business property in front of the business. So if you're pulling in out of a gas station, that's on the next page, or you're buying a pizza, please be careful, because our crashes that we're taking, apparently it's people coming to pick up something, fuel, pizza, whatever. So we were at 3 gas stations and Pizza Plus. So just be careful, especially when adverse weather, and I'm sure we're going to get more. Then for the council, there is a list of calls that the deputies handled, and there's about 63 of them, and that's counting traffic calls. And then I'm still working on something to put those together so we can get some numbers on them. Hopefully I'll have that next month. With that, is there any questions?
Mr. Rhodes?
I see everything on here from forgery, theft, overdose. What's a miscellaneous call?
Miscellaneous call?
Yeah. Is that just like my dog's next door neighbor's dog was barking?
Yeah, that could be. Most of the time we list that as a barking dog. A miscellaneous call is right. There's a property dispute. It could be someone walking down the street. We don't know who they are and they want them checked out. Those could be miscellaneous calls. That.
I just wondered because it was pretty detailed, and then I saw a few more miscellaneous calls.
Miscellaneous calls is like, I don't know what to list it, so let's call it a miscellaneous call.
Sounds good.
Good intent.
Yeah. Sorry, I just have one. Do you know what the story is on shots fired on Prentice? Just out of curiosity.
Well, actually, I do. These are listed as how we receive them. Okay, so someone called in, shots fired. Actually, the deputy that responded, and I think it was Deputy Cruz, it was like a backfire on a car. We couldn't determine there were shots fired, in other words.
Okay. All right.
It's a good thing. Now, what's not listed on here are all the things they do in between the calls. And I've covered that before, and hopefully we'll be gaining more information as time goes on.
Thanks, Sarge.
Thanks, sir.
Is this moving on?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Sergeant Underwood. And under informational items, I've had this on it before. I still like to know. I don't have as many likes as I want to have by now. But we do have a City of New Carlisle Facebook page, so please like and share it. That will be used directly to send information to our residents and business owners. So please get on your phone, find us. We are the one with the city seal and the logo and a picture of our downtown. There are a few different sites for New Carlisle, and there's also New Carlisle, Indiana. So don't like New Carlisle, Indiana, and expect those things to happen here because we're going to be lost. But please go to your Facebook, please like it and share it. It is full of a ton of great informative information. I know Chief Trussey already touched on this, but we did have a Lupus Tool fundraiser, the Gold Bar Chief, thanks to Security National Bank. Also thanks to all donors, especially Fab Metals. We'll have more information at Town Hall meeting to be released on that. But again, thank you to all who took part and donated to get us that life-saving tool. We truly do appreciate it. And for you students in the audience, I can't remember if he explained what a Lupus Tool does. It's automatic CPR. So if you're in the back of an ambulance, you can strap that thing on you. It's going to give you chest compressions, and that other person's free to work on you doing other things as opposed to just manually doing chest compressions. So that's why it's a very important tool for us to have in our arsenal of our other life-saving tools.
And how much is that, just so they know?
One tool's about $13,400, but we had a grant to get half of it and then the fundraising for some of it. And Ohio Checkbook, first meeting was on 2/16 of this year. It went fantastic. The goal was to announce the site as being public at Town Hall on 3/6/17. This date may change if the building of the site runs into any issues, but we did get notification today that it is complete. We will have our review call here in the next week or two. I can't remember the date off the top of my head. But again, the first meeting went fantastic. There was a little bit of miscommunication between the city and the state last time around. The state thought we were actually launching the site. It was done. That's not the case. So we'll be having a media blitz and all that when we actually do go to launch it, hopefully at the Town Hall meeting. But the initial process was fantastic. It went very smooth. And I think that me and Ms. Harris learned a lot from the process. We're very excited to see the end product. Congressman Warren Davidson will hold mobile office hours at the city building on the fourth Tuesday of each month from 2 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. I do have that posted on our city Facebook page, so make sure you see the event on there. And if you do want to come talk to a representative from Warren Davidson's office, he'll be there at 2 to 2:30 on the following days. And lastly, on the city manager's report, I had a meeting this morning in regards to our website and the upgrade. I do have a proposal from Digital Graphics to do that. The price was very, very, very good. Our initial meeting today was kind of like a Q&A back and forth. I'm going to add some council headshots. I'm going to get some headshots of us administrator. Really want that website to be as professional looking as it can be, given the budget we want to do it on. That is our window to the world. So we want to put our best foot forward. But in the coming month or two, I'll be requesting council members go and get a headshot done. We'll take care of it on all behalf. I'll tell you guys where to go. And then we're going to build that site. We'll also have a link for our online water payments. And then also what me and you discussed, Mr. Mayor, we're looking at how to, for our citizens, be able to submit something. Like trash was picked up at Prentice, or bulk pickup needed here, or whatever the case may be, so they can have a one-stop shop with our website. So very excited with that. Once we have everything finalized, we'll definitely present that to council. And I do believe that is all I have for my city manager report, so I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Council? I just have one, Mr. Bridge.
Sure.
The old Speedway that's sitting, I know that I think they're using it for practice on maintenance storage. I don't think that building is breaking any city codes, per se, as far as the siding falling off of bricks or whatever it may be. But mm-hmm. Is there any way we could send them a letter to do something with it?
Well,
it is a huge eyesore. I'm shocked that they want to leave it the way it is, sitting across the street from one of their brand new buildings.
Yeah, I highly doubt there's anything we can do with it. I already was looking at it today. They actually might be in violation of code, and I'm going to comb through our sign code. Because if they are using that as a training facility site for the maintenance workers, that is a business, and that business needs to be identified. So hopefully, push comes to someone, at least get a sign. Yes. They're not breaking any code other than that. I mean, landscaping, they don't have any landscaping issues. There's no structural issues. It would be a nice community partner, though, if they did put some flowers out there to make it somewhat look presentable. It's on a very heavily corner.
Some lights or something.
So Speedway is usually pretty good being community partners, so we'll reach out to them and see if they can knock it up a little bit, absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it. All righty. Moving on, we will go to comments from the members of the public. This is you guys' time. If you have any questions or comments or anything you want to ask or say, please go to the podium and say what you need to say.
Deer and headlights. I don't want to say anything.
All right. We'll move on. Committee reports done tonight, so we'll move on to resolutions.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
I move to adopt resolution 17-03R.
I second.
Oh, Lordy, yes. I'm sorry.
I would jump in the gun.
Before I read it, I want to do a little education with the audience since we have so many students here. If you look at our agenda, we have resolutions and we have ordinances. For example, resolution 17-03R stands for resolution year 2017, and 03 means it's the third resolution we've considered this year in the year, and that's how we keep track of it. Under the ordinances, you'll see the same type of setup, ordinance 17-03, and that just tells you that's the third ordinance that we've introduced for council this year. So see, it's been worth coming tonight, correct? E stands for, if one has an E attached to it, that means it's an emergency ordinance, and they can act on it tonight, and it bypasses the introduction and the 14-day notice. Ready?
Yes, sir.
All right. Did you guys do 17?
You what?
I never knew that.
Resolution 17-03R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution strongly opposing the state of Ohio governor's proposed 2017-2018 budget, which includes the centralization collection of net profit tax returns and other provisions relating to municipal income tax, which will cause a substantial loss of revenue needed to support the health, safety, welfare, and economic development efforts of Ohio municipalities.
Mr. Mayor, move we adopt resolution 17-03R.
I second.
Motion by Mr. Reynolds, second by Mr. Kraybacher.
Yes.
And you got some explaining.
I do. Part of my job is once he announces he takes the first and second to adopt it, then I give it just a brief overview of what the legislation is about. Everybody comes to council already reading it, but it is part of our process that we just give a brief overview for those who don't have that in the possession. So resolution 17-03R, this resolution opposes the centralized business tax collection Governor Kasich is trying to administer here in Ohio. Now, many across this great state oppose this legislation because, well, multiple things, but the big three ones for me at least is there's no way for us to ensure the accuracy of the filing and the proper remittance of tax due. Another thing is there's no answer to this yet, but there's no way for cities to be able to verify the refunds or returns are accurate. And then three, which is the big one for me, is it's a total attack on our home rule powers. Why is the state trying to take away something that we need? The state wants to take this large pot of money, put it in the bank, got a crap ton of interest on it, and then charge us to send us back our money. That's basically what this is in a nutshell.
Mr. Reynolds.
Just a quick question. When we, hopefully, if we pass this tonight, will we just send this to the governor's office? Will we also send this to our state representative and our state senator?
What I'll do is I'll send this back to I think we got it from OML. And
yeah,
then I'll also send it out to our county officials. I will send it out to neighboring counties and cities alike, and then take it from there. But we're seeing this ripple effect of different jurisdictions doing it, and then other jurisdictions piggybacking off of it. The legislation reads the same no matter what city.
Yeah, well, I agree. I would definitely recommend that we send this to our state rep and state senator, because they're going to be the ones that ultimately vote on this budget.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, as you know, Governor Kasich says he's a conservative and likes little government, but likes to get the biggest government possible involved in local municipality issues.
Sure.
So I definitely would highly recommend it to Representative Kaler and Senator Hackett.
Duly noted, and then good recommendation.
Also, they had the initiation to see how much money you would make off this new budget. And so they said, oh, when you look at it originally, it said 75,000 we might give from local government. And then when you went back and did it again, it went down to like 15,000. So we might not get any more money than we have already received from the local government fund. Mm-hmm.
And it just follows up on his other, I mean, you know, cutting tangible property tax, cutting the local government fund, strangling little municipalities. But the state's doing fantastic. They got a lot of money to bank, but we're the ones paying.
So we're paying for it. Not the big city.
Sure. They're not conservative whatsoever, so.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions, comments? Mr. Collier, when you're ready.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh?
For sure.
Resolution 17-03R passes 6-0.
I hit. One little bit.
All right.
I'll tell him if I.
Moving on to new ordinances.
First two I'm going to read are just the introductions tonight. Action will be on 3617. Ordinance 17-03, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 3617. An ordinance establishing compensation rates for certain management personnel. Ordinance 17-04, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 3617. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into any and all agreements on behalf of the city of New Carlisle for the signal upgrade project, Clark State Route 235, 4.44/4.77, including but not limited to the Ohio Department of Transportation. Ordinance 17-05, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 3617. An ordinance amending section 1043.05 of the codified ordinances of the city of New Carlisle regarding charges for the use of the municipal water supply.
Mr. Mayor.
It's
I'm sorry.
Mr. Lowry. I'd like to have the ordinance read in its entirety. Being introduced, and I think it should be read from top to bottom. 1705.
That's fine. That's all right. Read it entirely. This is one. Oh, okay. That's good.
Couple paragraphs.
Let me find it in my packet here. Oh, thank you, sir. Ordinance 17-05, an ordinance amending section 1043.05 of the codified ordinances of the city of New Carlisle regarding charges for the use of the municipal water supply. Whereas council has determined that it is necessary for adjustments to be made in the rate structure for water service provided by the city of New Carlisle. Now therefore, the municipality of New Carlisle hereby ordains that section 1043.05 of the codified ordinances of New Carlisle be amended by deleting it in its entirety and substituting the following. 10.1043.05 charges for the use of a municipal water supply. Thereby is hereby established a charge of 1,000 gallons of water used from the municipal water supply as follows. Commencing with uses beginning April 18, 2017 and continuing through April 17, 2018, usage, a charge of $8.74. Commencing with usage beginning April 18, 2018, and continuing through April 17, 2019, usage, a charge of $9.61. Commencing with usage beginning April 18, 2019, and continuing, a charge of $10.09.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. And as I stated, that would be considered and voted on by council on 3617.
Mr. Collier.
Yes.
Quick question. Would we be able to table this motion considering this ordinance considering it was introduced today for introductions?
No, you would table it next meeting.
At the next meeting, I think, so over Robert's rules of parliamentary procedure, I know it states that it can be table, but it never specified if it was an introduction period or not. I think we should probably have an open meeting more than just a a lot of time for the next one, because I feel like we might have a lot of people here that aren't students.
Well, that's why it's set for a reading on town hall, which is why I strategically had reading on town hall. We went through budget discussions that this was on a timed frame here. Yeah. So if you table this ordinance the next 2 weeks and you wait and it has to go back, that coding is no longer to be used, you're going to have 30% on the cost as we discussed. So I strategically had it voted on the town hall so people can come. I mean, up to you guys, I'm just letting you know. The reason why I was on town voting was simply because of that. So I thought it'd be a lot more enticing for citizens to come and get their kids.
And that's exactly why I asked to have it read in its entirety, not just the top of it.
Sure.
So that the information will get out there.
At the end of the day, that's your guys' call, how you want to handle it. But just understand that if you table it and doesn't pass, we're under time frame. Which we open to discuss at the open budget meeting that we discussed it as well.
On that particular ordinance on the water, I think it should be very well publicized, either on our city site that we are considering this, but we'll have an ordinance in front of us. And I also think there should be something in the newspapers about it, to bring people to that town hall so we can hear from the people on what they want us to do and explain to them why this may be necessary.
Sure.
I don't know what your plans was as far as Mr. Collier or you, Mr. Bridge, as far as getting this out to the public, but I am sure it'll show up on Facebook this evening sometime.
Well, I looked at it as we were going to release some information on town hall meeting. We, as administrators, gave you the information at the budget work session on Thursday. I was hoping that council could learn the information and kind of engage the citizens that elected them to know what's going on as well. But we did have plans to release information at the town hall meeting on that. I could put stuff on our Facebook page. It's not a problem.
Okay. That I would appreciate sense. It, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Now, but the... Isn't the council meeting before the town hall meeting?
No, it's council meeting and town hall meeting.
But isn't the council meeting before that? In other words, we'll be voting on it before the town hall meeting.
Yeah, but the information will obviously be released when with the ordinance. That we're not going to do
right.
The ordinance.
But, so it doesn't do really have anything to do. People can say anything they want to at the town hall meeting, but it's going to be too late.
They can say anything they want in the council meeting, too.
If they're here, if they know that the council meeting is going to be a half an hour before the town hall meeting, I think that's where the confusion might come.
Okay.
So, just to tell you.
I will do I will put it on Facebook and stuff like that. I mean.
That's the best you can do.
And there'll be a legal notice in the paper.
There'll be a legal notice.
It
has to be.
Yeah, always is.
Okay.
But I mean, what I'm trying to get at here is this is not 100% our responsibility to inform the citizens. You guys need to do your part in learning the project and being able to openly discuss this if you call on the street. You know, I know you guys all have Facebook and you guys talk to your constituents. We would do what we need to do, but I really encourage council to talk on behalf of this as well.
I have already talked it up already.
Sure.
I just think they wanted to get out onto what sources are dedicated to only the city as far as that page.
Sure.
And the city thing. I personally wouldn't mind, you know, I don't know what the rest of the group thinks, but I would like to have just talking. I'd love to have a meeting, another meeting discussing the financial options on this project before we vote on it. But that's just me.
Well, you have, if you want to set a special meeting for that, that's your guys' liberty. We will make it happen.
Sounds good.
But it seems like to me,
I'm
not.
Go on. Seems to you,
Mr. Kitka, if I might jump to you real quick, the adhesion test they were talking about, is that what you called it?
Adhesion and cohesion, yes.
Okay. I mean, I know that in the meeting you guys talked about, you know, the test could be good today and tomorrow it could be completely gone. I mean, but is there any, did they give you any indication that it looks good for 6 months, 6 years, I mean, nothing? I mean, you would figure in their profession they would be able to give you some sort of ballpark.
That's their ballpark. I mean, they're not scientists. So, I mean, it may sound like I'm not trying to give you like specific, but that's just the way it is. I mean, I can call them for a dead eye answer, but It's the standard. You just don't know unless they came every day and every day did a test, next day did a test, next day did a test.
Okay, so could we, would you guys think about setting a meeting before the town hall and doing that?
That same day?
The same
before?
Day or?
Before or
next week?
Or
next week?
You think like before the city council meeting?
Yeah.
Before the council meeting.
Next week?
Right.
It'd have to be next week. If we did it, Mr. Mayor, before the next council/town hall meeting, if we did it on that day, then a lot of people don't get home from work, you know, till 4 or 5 o'clock. So if we did it at 5 o'clock, we may or may not have anybody here. I would like to see it done on a separate day and do it at 7 o'clock and then advertise the bejeezies out of it so the citizens know that what is before us and what is really before them.
Can I make a suggestion? Because we've got a lot of back-end work into this, that we've connected people to actually come, which we had the budget work session, we said we'd have people coming. So now I have to get back to check their availability, see if they can come to whatever meeting you guys set. So if you could, I don't know how we're going to play this off, but there's a lot of back-end information that's going on that's, and I get, you guys go to a special meeting, that's fine. I just wish Thursday at the budget work session, we should have had this game planned out because I never would have introduced this legislation, schedule somebody to come and have to worry about all this stuff. So
I don't think we need them to come to the meeting, because we're just going to be discussing.
He was going to come to the meeting that they voted on.
We still want him to. I'm saying he wouldn't necessarily need to be at the special meeting,
Mr. Mayor.
Because I mean, we're going to be looking at just financial options on our end.
I think lead into other kind of questions about what's going on, the ins and outs of what's going on. I mean, that's it. You're not going to get a town hall meeting and say we're just going to stick to how we're financing. People don't want to ask questions about why it's there, why is it taking so long to get fixed and stuff like that. So I think we need to be prepared at this special meeting you're going to call to have every box checked and covered. So if somebody does have a question, the last thing that you say or I say is we'll get back to you. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Okay, would it be possible for you to get back with us real soon so we can kind of plan for a meeting maybe next week? Late next week? Or do we have to advertise?
Oh, you got to advertise at least 24 hours.
Well, 24 hours we can have it done before, you know, with the next newspaper.
Do you think that more people will come to a town hall meeting or more people's going to come to a special meeting?
You really want to know my, you know, from experience? I don't think it'll come in.
Don't make any difference what meeting it is.
Matter.
No. You only need to have a special meeting if you plan on at that point in time of passing some sort of legislation. If you're just going to have a discussion, you can call it a work session.
Okay.
It doesn't need to be an official regular meeting. So you can just have a motion to have a meeting.
I'm sorry, John. Somebody else have your hand up. I apologize. Go ahead.
I just wanted to, I think why it was mentioned that having these people come to an earlier meeting is so if the public shows up, the public can ask them these questions and hear it straight from the horse's mouth instead of hearing it from us or hearing it from the city. Or, you know, I've been reading, doing a lot of reading here. Again, it's on Facebook. A lot of people are in an uproar over a lot of different things right now. And I think once they find out that this ordinance is going to raise their water rates by 20% this year and another 10% next year and then another 5% to equate to 35%, I think if they know that, they may come and either voice their opinion not to do it, or we can explain to them why we might need to do it as far as this tower not being serviced or anything done to it theoretically for 40 years since it's been built. If I understood the conversation the other night, Mr.
Kicker. Since 1985, so it's been about
32
years.
Okay.
My thought on the meeting is I, you know, Randy, I don't, in council, I don't want to just show up to the first meeting and we have a group of people and we, you know, let's just say we pass a conversation, say, and then the general public's like, why didn't you guys look at another conference? I think we need to show that, and I know we touched on it, at the finance meeting, but I think we need to make sure that they know that we've looked into it every other possible way.
I mean, we've heard, you have two options. Either you pass it as is, or you don't pass it, and then you'll see another smaller rate to yourself. I mean, that's really two options. Well, if when it comes to funding or funding options, you can take out a loan. So
if we can get the work session before the next meeting, then we shouldn't have to worry about drawing out any farther than the original date that we're set up.
That's on. We work at the liberty of council, so whatever you guys want to do, let us know, and we will make that happen.
Okay. First and foremost, I personally don't think a person sitting here is going to question that the water tank needs to be worked on, okay? I'm not going to question a layer of paint on that water tank that's been there for 32 years. That's everybody's drinking water, and I think we all want it safe. The reason I wanted it red was, as I said, so people know what's going on. I think the only questions we can ask you people sitting over there is, has every option to pay for this been looked at? And quite frankly, I don't think it has. I could be dead wrong on this. Don't take it personal.
No.
I think there's other things that we need to look at. And I will tell you now, once they're brought up, if you look at me and say, you don't know what in the world you're talking about, you're dead wrong, you show it to me, I'm sorry. But it is my duty as a council person to see if we can get it done any cheaper, any less expensive. That's my main concern. Not that I thought anybody lied to me, not that I thought that anybody did something wrong. It is our duty to make sure we get it done the best possible way we can do it for the best price possible. There is no doubt in my mind that water tank needs to be fixed. Mm-hmm. I found out it's 32 years and it hasn't been touched. I've been buying bottled water.
I agree.
I want us to make sure we're satisfied with every option that's been looked at. Okay?
I'm right there with you.
Thank you. That's all I want.
I would have just would appreciate it on Thursday when we're having a probably hour and a half discussion on this at our budget work session.
Okay.
That the people who are in attendance would have said, do not introduce this legislation. We are going to have a town hall. We're going to have a public forum, open meeting. Now we've got multiple hours of work that me and this fine man, young man here put into this.
And I know
to lead up to this. And I think communication needs to be a lot better when it comes to big things like this, because Thursday, there is every opportunity to say what exactly we're saying here.
Okay.
But now that the ordinance is there, we'll go ahead and do it, but there's a lot of work that has been wasted the past week because of that.
Well, I think it's going to be very well published. Dale's back there, and I can guarantee you.
Sure. Absolutely.
You know, to my knowledge. It's going to be all over Facebook. I can promise you that. Okay. The information is going to get out
there. Mr. Mayor. You know, to follow up with Mr. Lowry on, you know, the needs maintenance and stuff, I think everybody thinks and knows that. It's also our duty as a council to make sure we have good, clean drinking water for the citizens of this city. I guess the biggest problem I have is a 35% rate increase over the next 3 years. It just sounds massive to me. Although when you look at the numbers, it don't seem all that bad, but a 35% rate increase is just, I think, is asinine, to tell you the truth.
Hard to swallow.
And to follow up on your remarks, sir, that, you know, we should have brought this up when we was talking about it, you know, the other night. I think, I don't know, I can't speak for everybody, but for myself, I take everything it's said in these meetings, and I think about them. And I may think of something 2 or 3 days later that I didn't think of in that meeting. So, you know, and I understand that you want things to work quicker, but we're the ones that they're going to skin alive if we do the wrong thing. Or, you know... Yeah, I'm just going to stop there. I would ask the mayor and rest of the council to have you check with the other people who is involved in this, find out their schedule, see if we can get something this week or first part of next week, get it into the paper, whether it be, I know New Carlisle News only does a paper once a week. They do have a website. We can get it on there. We can get it on our city website. We can get it in Springfield, Dayton paper. We just have to advertise it and then have that meeting as soon as possible if rest of council agrees with what I just said.
Mr. Kramer.
I agree. When I went home after the meeting, you know, start thinking about it. Basically what they say, you sleep on it, and then that's what I did. I said, and that's why I agree with it. You know,
it's not that it shouldn't be been said that, you know, sometimes all this information comes at you, so you have to sort it out. And I've talked to a couple of citizens about that, and they're kind of like, what? And they're, like I said before, they're on fixed income. Yeah, so I go, what's, you know, what's the possible other possibility? And there was a possibility that came across me today, and I was, you know, so.
Sure.
Suggestion.
I think it's around.
Mr. Reynolds.
I'll let Mr. Collier comment first. He's a wealth of knowledge here.
The only suggestion I would say is that you move this ordinance into the town hall part of the meeting so you can have a discussion and have an open discussion about it if you want to do it that way.
That's completely legal.
Well, the town hall meeting is part of a regular meeting.
Good.
I mean,
that's an excellent idea.
It's a town hall meeting.
So move excellent idea.
Could we vote on it then?
But say,
you could vote
in the town hall.
You could vote on in the town hall meeting as part meeting. As long as it's on the agenda that way.
Correct.
Mr. Lighting?
Well, I'd be okay with that. You know,
yeah.
Again, like everybody else, water is a necessity. I don't see any of us voting this down. We just want to make sure we cover all our options. More importantly, make sure everybody in the city realizes what we're trying to accomplish and why we're trying to accomplish it. So I think if we're able to vote for it in a town hall meeting, you know, let people do their presentation, you know, let us say their comments, let them say their comments, you know, maybe that's the way to go as opposed to try to squeeze in a special meeting to complicate everything else.
I'd go for that.
And I appreciate that. That deserves all the work that we've done leading up to that March 6th. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Yeah, that's my compliment.
You just moved that ordinance underneath the town hall part of the agenda.
I'm okay with that if anyone else is.
Thank you. Mr. Reynolds,
let's do a motion on that just to make it as official as we can.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lowry.
Can you read the language on that motion, sir?
Who's
this?
Mr. Reynolds.
Mr. Reynolds.
And that was a motion.
And Mr. Bridge.
To move.
Mr. Bridge, Mr. Kitko, Ms. Harris, I mean, don't take any of this the wrong way. This is, we just want to be as thorough as possible. I'm not saying that you guys haven't done your job.
No, it's very respectful and refreshing to hear that. I was just trying to preserve the hours of work that we have put into it already. I'm thoroughly glad you guys are taking that extra step. From this end, it was just, we've got a lot of man hours involved in it at this point. But I think you guys are doing the exact step that you need to do with this.
The motion basically states that ordinance 17-05 will be moved to the town hall portion of the meeting.
That is correct.
All right, let's vote.
That's exactly what I said.
Mr. Craig.
Yes.
And I heard him say
it. Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Lighting.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Passes 6-0. Okay.
Mr. Collier, real quick before we move on, I'm going to let Mr. Cobb, he's got a question.
Mr. Mayor, before he gets to that, I think you need to listen.
Oh, sorry.
So my quick question is there, I know it's short notice, you know, I discussed said Thursday work session, but is there any possible way to look at like also financing options for that meeting? Financing options? I think that, like, you know, I had advocated for that during that meeting, so I just wanted to see if that would be something. Say what?
You got 2 weeks.
Well.
I think we could pay cash for it, but, you know.
Out of your pocketbook. But yeah, I'd like to see financing
options.
You
wouldn't get that out of mine.
So, if at all possible.
Which guy did?
All right. That was it.
Any other you guys want us to do prepare for that information that we can give? We've got financing options. We're going to look at other things that we've already.
That's basically what we all want. So that next meeting, we can reject every option.
So do you want us to focus more on how we're going to pay for it versus less on what the issue is? Or do we do a mixture of what the issue is with what's going on?
I think what the issue is.
Explained. I mean,
we know the issue. I think we all know the issue.
Well, we do.
But the citizens don't know that issue.
The audience doesn't.
Yes.
Well, after the town hall, because we've got that company coming, so they'll know that issue.
Right, hopefully.
Let me vote on it.
Hopefully.
Mr. Bridge, if we've got, and I had an idea, if we have a finance idea on this project, should I email it to you so you can look into it?
Yeah, as soon as you guys can get us any kind of recommendations or you're Googling whatever and you say, hey, look at that, let us know. We're going to be starting our finalized PDF essentially to you guys here probably by the end of the week. have it done, and then we'll take a couple days to review it, and then it'll be part of the packet that we give out for all that stuff. But yeah, anything that you want to know about, let us know kind of in advance. I want to try to get this done, like I said, at the end of the week. Maybe have a Monday or Tuesday for additions or cleaning it up. But once that Wednesday next week comes around, trying to get everything done earlier, because it's going to be a massive packet with regular council meeting and the town hall packet. So that means me finalizing the budget. There's a lot going on in the next 2 weeks. Ample time, we'll have everything you need.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
One last one, I promise you this, about this for me. With financing options, I know that if we were to take that money and then from the general fund and then switch over, we have to pay back. Do you know at what rate we'd have to pay back? That'd be my question, because we do have a surplus.
Okay.
And I don't know like what rate it would be, so that was just my only one. That's also part of the financing one I would like to look at. Awesome. That's it. Promise.
As a matter of fact, I was already looking that up with David Yost's site.
Yes.
And they are considered short-term, and short-term is usually year two. They do transfers, so if that enterprise fund, which is called a restricted fund, is not able to pay that back within a short-term, you have to actually make that then a transfer for permanent. And then they won't pay it back. So there's no, like, 5-year, 10-year, 15-year.
Okay.
There's no such thing.
That was my question last week, because, you know, I just said on the auditor site, you know, our infrastructure was rated in the yellow. So I just want to make sure that if we were to give it over, would we have to do permanent transfer, or would it be, hey, you got to pay us back? So,
yeah,
so
I got a little more digging on that for some particulars, but that was some of Dave Yost's PowerPoint presentation that I sent.
Oh, fantastic. All right. Well,
awesome.
Happy to clear that up for last Thursday.
Mr. Todd.
Good.
I'm in the dark here. Are we talking about water plant?
No.
Water tower?
Water tower.
Drinking water and the water tower?
Water tower.
Towers, both. We know the one here on Jefferson is in bad shape. That was supposed to, 2 years ago, we talked about tearing it down.
It is built.
This one concerning mostly Scarf Tower. Okay, the one out on Scarf Road 2 years ago, it was said that it was in A1 shape, because they discussed about tearing this one down there.
I think structurally they're saying it's solid. It's not good.
They didn't.
But when it comes to paint and cleaning and things like that, is what we're discussing.
No, we knew the outside had to be painted on the one up here.
Yeah,
and that's what we're talking about. We're talking about that, and also the inside has not been painted. That we know.
Hadn't been touched for 32 years.
The inside.
What is the cost for the painting on the outside?
Let's, Mr. Cobb, if you don't mind, I'm going to stop. and not that I don't want you to know, but
yeah.
let's save this for the town hall meeting. We're going to discuss it all, and then we'll go over it, if you don't mind.
Mr. Cobb, enough to us to warrant a special meeting. That's how much.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's right.
Yeah, that's
it.
It got our eyebrows.
It got our eyebrows.
Are you able to send Mr. Cobb Howie's memo?
Yeah, we can send it.
Send that to Mr. Cobb.
You what?
Mr. Kitko did a pretty thorough memo about 2 weeks ago, and could that be sent to him?
To
your letter, that you, your memo you put together, shared with council and everybody.
Okay.
It's got pretty informational. It says a lot.
Mr. Lindsay?
Maybe Mr. Cobb would like to write us a check, is why he wanted to know how much his was.
Maybe.
Bring on. All right. Mr. Collier, moving on, sir. You're ready.
Ordinance 17-06E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to sign a memorandum of understanding agreement with the New Carlisle Healthcare Facilities, LLC, the owner of Bell Manor Nursing Home, and declaring it an emergency.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Rhodes.
Move to adopt ordinance 17-06E.
Second.
That's a first.
Whatever.
Okay. Give it to Mr. Lyman.
Yeah, give it to the
Explanation of this ordinance. This ordinance will allow the city to begin the process of accepting the Bell Manor donation. Please understand this step is crucial to the overall process, and it does not bind the city in accepting the donation in any way.
Council, any questions, comments? When you're ready, Mr. Collier.
Mr. Lowry, Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Passes 6-0.
Okay. What about Mr. Lighty?
Mr. Lighty, yeah. You missed him.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Now it passes 6-0.
Can I ask a question? Yes,
you feeling a little left out there, were you?
Mr. Kramer has a question.
May I have a question?
Sure.
First, on page 4.
Of the agreement, MOU?
Of the agreement.
Okay. What number you have?
Number 2.
Okay.
It says, and I don't know if this makes any difference, and maybe I'm wrong. NCHF shall transfer to city by quit claim. Is that supposed to be quick claim?
No, it's quit.
Is it quit? Mm-hmm.
Quit claim deed.
You're quitting the claim. You're walking away from it.
Oh.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Well, that makes sense.
And prior to 2 weeks ago, I
was there such a thing as a quit claim?
I think there is, actually, but don't quote me on that.
Is it? Whoever does real estate, let me know. Whoever does real estate, let me know.
Ordinance 17-07E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to sign an agreement with CTL Engineering for a Phase 1 environmental site assessment and an asbestos study on Bell Manor Nursing Home in preparation for the possible donation of Bell Manor Building to the city of New Carlisle.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Craybaugh.
I'd like to make a motion for ordinance 17-07E.
Second.
Mr. Lindsay, you got one.
I will stop. I'll let you handle it from now on. That's all I do.
You guys. I don't remember that.
Point. Discussion?
No.
Yes.
You first and second already?
Yes.
Okay.
Next explanation
of this ordinance. This ordinance will allow me to sign the agreement with CTL Engineering for Phase 1 environmental site assessment. Phase 1 site assessment is going to be qualitative study. It's going to look to see if there's any ground contaminants and stuff like that. And then the asbestos study will allow us to locate if there's any asbestos tile or in the drywall in the building as a whole. I highly recommend doing both tests. Even though the prior Phase 1 was done in 2013, we only have a 180-day shelf life. With a project as big as this, we need to make sure we have every one of our T's and I's crossed and I's dotted. So I will be signing an agreement for both the studies, Phase 1 and asbestos.
I'm going to assume, Mr. Bridge, if you got a reply on the letter. I'm assuming you got a reply on our letter.
Reply on a letter?
That was sent to
Did you not send that?
To pay.
Never got a reply.
Never got a reply?
Nope, because I haven't sent it yet.
You haven't sent it?
No. So don't try to word it out. Sorry to discourage you, but this is something that I am walking on eggshells with because it is something that can very easily offend them and say, we're just not going to go through. I highly intend on sending the letter, but I am looking for the best way to word it.
Okay. Ask him to
and I will copy you in onto it, not a problem. But I'm walking on this one with eggshells.
Yes. Mr. Reynolds.
I move that we table ordinance 17-07E. Until the next meeting, until that letter is sent.
Second.
Really? Because if you pay for it and they end up paying for it, you just reimburse the city.
Yeah.
So I don't know why you would delay the process.
I agree. If they're going to pay for it, they'll just reimburse.
Are they going to pay for it?
I don't know.
No.
Well, but if they don't pay for it.
Until we know, then why are we going to?
Because we need to have it done regardless if they pay for it or not.
I agree that we need to know what's in the building, but if we would like to see if they would pay for it first. And if they say no, then we can just go vote on this in the next meeting.
I'll leave it to council that strategy. No offense to you, Mr. Reynolds.
That's quite all right.
Sense. Because, again, we have to pay for it anyway. So if they come back and say no, we're just delaying the start process at that point in time.
Well, we obviously have different sides of this. But
well, we have a motion on the table, so.
We do.
Ready for the vote, Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Lindsay.
I second it. I thought.
Yeah.
No, Mr. Reynolds did.
No, he made it. I made the motion.
He made the motion.
He seconded the motion.
Yeah. Ethan made the motion. And Bill
seconded. John made it. That's what I had wrote down. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I did too.
The what?
I thought you made the motion. That's what I wrote down. Okay. Can't tell
okay,
your voice though.
Mr. Lindsay, you made the second?
Yes.
Okay, gotcha.
Well, I made the original motion.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
We heard it down at this end of the table. It was you, but anyway.
Mr. Lighting.
Is it going to make any difference?
What?
Okay, is this what you're asking? Excuse me. Are you asking for the motion, for the ordinance, or for the motion to table the ordinance?
The motion to vote on the actual ordinance.
No, I made that.
I motioned to table.
But he made a motion and they seconded it to
table.
To table.
So that overrode my.
You have to address that motion first.
Am I right?
And that's why you had Mr. Kraybacher down, because he motioned and then I.
On the original one, yes.
Exactly.
So it was John Kraybacher.
My understanding, Mr. Lighting, is my understanding, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I mean, either way, it's going to have to be done whether they pay for it or not.
You guys can deny having the first one done and that's the study done altogether.
True.
Right. Yeah, we can do that.
But at the end of the day,
we need to know what's in there, right?
If I was on that council, I'd be having every test that needs to be done because you guys don't want to be 20 years.
And I agree with
that council going saying, well, Madison School or whatever, you know. Right. So you need to make sure that the buildings. We need to do our due diligence to make sure the building's good.
All right. Just to follow up, I'm not opposed to having us test.
No, I didn't think
at all. I just think that if they would be willing to pay for it, great. If not, no big deal. Let's pay for it. But I would prefer them to actually send us a response, or you send a letter to get a response. That's my issue. It's not an issue that I don't want to pay for it. Trust me, I want to know what's in there as much as the next guy. But if they're going to pay for it, I mean, they're the ones that are giving it to us. I'd rather have them go through all the traps on it than us.
And Mr. Lobby, I'm just making sure you understand you're voting yes or no
to table it.
To table it, yeah.
I think it's more important for us to get in there, and if it makes no difference, I'm going to go ahead and say no.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Okay, once again, you know, I understand where they're coming from, but I don't want to delay getting it checked, inspected, you know, and if they're going to pay for it, they're going to pay for it either way, so respectfully.
Put that
note.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Kraybacher.
No.
Mayor Lowry.
I would vote no.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Motion fails 4-2, 2-4. So now we still have the motion on the table to vote on the original ordinance.
John.
Okay, I gotta rewrite this.
Was it Ethan?
Yes.
Okay, Mr. Kraybacher made that original motion.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I confused you.
Who made the second?
Ethan.
I made the second.
All right.
Got it. Okay, so we have a motion by Mr. Kraybacher and a second by Mr. Reynolds on ordinance 17-07E.
Any discussion before we move on, Councilman? Mr. Reynolds.
I won't be voting for this because we don't know if they would pay for it, and that was something that this council had asked you to do, and I know that you said the wording wasn't right, so I will be voting now. I just want to make sure, that is known. It's not that I'm against testing either.
Just make I didn't
sure
take it like that.
Okay, I was making sure that's exactly clear.
Mr.
Comfort,
your vote?
You're ready.
Mr. Lindsay?
No.
Mr. Lighting?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
No.
Ordinance 17-07E passes 4-2.
If it's emergency ordinance, does it fail?
Yes, it does.
Yes.
Needs 5 votes.
Yep.
Sure does.
He had one absent.
Yep. All right. So we'll just have to reintroduce it next time. Doesn't work that way. I think you just delayed the process by 2 weeks, but.
Mr. Bridge, how close are you to having the letter drafted to send to them to request them to pay for this?
I have it done by the end of the day tomorrow, but I honestly think it's, and this is my recommendation, I think it's a horrible taste for this city to write them a letter asking them to pay $6,000 of phase one environmental, that's our responsibility, when they are gifting us a just under $1 million building, even though they'll get the tax credit for the year. They will. We're going to see the long-term benefit of it.
Yeah,
You know, so I think it's in really bad taste. That's like somebody giving you a house and saying, I need you to pay
the taxes.
I need you to pay the transfer fee. I honestly think it's going to make us look like unthankful, greedy folks. If you want my professional opinion, my other professional opinion on this, I will respectfully remind you six up there that you are more than welcome to write letters on your behalf to the city of New Carlisle for this. You know, so you guys all have letterhead. I will do it because one council member asked me to do it. And I've been in communication with Mr. Mayor about it. This is a very hard letter to write. I'm trying to craft it so we don't look like greedy people. I will have that done by end of business day tomorrow. I will send it out to him. I'll probably send it via email. I will copy council in on it. We'll wait and see what their response is.
I would think by it being a nursing home that the state has already kept up on these inspections or these types of inspections, would they not, you think? I mean, you've had discussions with them, so I'm not sure.
I mean, the state's not going to require a phase one environmental every year. The last one they had, again, was in 2013. Those are good for 180 days. The phase one that we're getting is just a supplemental. They're going to go in and recheck everything to make sure everything's still valid off the last one. The big one that you should be concerned about, phase one should be, yeah, it's not going to change. We know they haven't put underground tanks in. Your big concern should be the asbestos. You guys want to put council chambers over there. The moment you go in and knock down a wall, they're going to make sure there's going to be no asbestos either. You know, and I think by not passing this ordinance tonight, this council has delayed the process by 2 weeks when we're kind of already trying to get the ball rolling. Regardless of who pays for it, either them or us, if we went ahead and I signed this agreement, we cut a check for $6,000 today, and then they get the letter next week and said, yes, we'll pay for it, we just reimburse ourselves. So to me, failing this ordinance today made absolute no sense. And it just prolonged the process even more. And it basically looks like two people didn't want to vote to have a phase one or asbestos done. So I'm trying to make this the most smoothest transition we have. This was on a time frame. So, I mean, it's not a big deal. I can just reintroduce it next week after we get the letter. But them saying yes or no is not going to change the outcome of what we need to do. So we just literally added 2 weeks onto the process for no reason whatsoever. Unless council doesn't want a phase one or asbestos done at all.
I would think that it being a nursing home, that it would not be able to operate as one if it had asbestos in it.
Again.
But we need to know for ourselves, because I just don't think the state would allow asbestos to be in a nursing home. You know, I know it's an old home, maybe at one time it did, but I think at some point they'd have to take it out.
Actually,
but we do need to know, we probably do need to have these tests. But with our financial situation, I know our general fund is getting there, but it isn't there. I just think if we can save that $6,000 out front money and they pick up the tab, I think that's the best way to go. That's the reason I voted no. It's nothing against you, or I don't want these tests, these tests are essential, I think, for us to, as a council, decide if we're going to do this. But I don't think the city is financially stable enough, really, to lay out all this extra money if we don't have to. I understand if they pay for it, we're going to get it back.
No, I understand that. But what you said earlier was we need to have it done, and we should have it done. But you should have somebody pay for it. It's going to get done regardless. Do you agree that it should be done?
Oh, absolutely it should be done.
Now,
I just hope they would like for them to pay for it.
There could be, but I'm just saying, if you're, and they're saying that it needs to be done, and you agree that the tests need to be done, then what's it matter if we pay for it or they pay for it, we just reimburse ourselves. So that's where I'm at right now. But to answer your question, sir, there could be asbestos in there now. It could be in a carpet tile that they have, in a tile that they have carpet over, which is fine. But the moment you go to knock down a wall or move a room, now you have to address that asbestos under the tile. So that's why it's crucial to have that test done, because the moment that we knock down a wall for council chambers, we need to know what's underneath the tile. Does that make sense?
I understand.
Sure.
Yeah.
Again.
Sure, sir.
Oh, Mr. Ryan. again, my opposition isn't to the testing. My opposition is that a member of this council had asked you to send this letter and the letter was not sent.
Mm-hmm.
And that is my only opposition to it.
Mm.
And that'll be all my comments I have on this.
Council, any other questions or comments?
Can I say something?
You can say something. Give me just a second there, Mr. Collier.
Sure.
Mr. Cradle.
Okay. I want to thank everybody on council for excusing me for being gone for a month. It was an amazing trip. It was a trip for the Church of the Brethren in USA to observe the Church of the Brethren in Nigeria and what they're doing. And what they are doing, what we did experience is several IDP camps. And we talked to a lot of people that their husbands or their sons, and a lot of times their daughters, have been taken by the Boko Haram. And we've documented a lot of their stories. I talked to a gentleman who spent 21 days out in the woods with his two daughters, trying to escape the Boko Haram. I also talked to a man who stayed, talking about tiles in the ceiling of his house, while the Boko Haram daily was looking for him. You know, and he would come down during the day and get water, and his wife would give him water, and he'd get food. He'd spend 15, 20 minutes down, you know, on the first floor, but then rush back up because the Boko Haram was still in their village. Churches being burned and bombed. I know what it's like now to be in an area where laws are not enforced and the police actually stand on the corner and watch other people getting beat up because of their religious beliefs. I know what it's like not to have water, but to drink bottled water the whole time because the water is not safe to drink. I also know what it's like not to have streets. Now, Mr. Cobb, you talk about potholes in the streets. You talk about trash. I was in a country that had that because the government didn't do nothing. We do something. And I observed people hungry, and that's where I was then for a month. You know, being with these people, understanding their stories. You know, but what they did do, with great joy, they worked hard, and they said they work hard for a better future. Now, we were in a town in Maiduguri where we stayed in a hotel. And they said it was the best fortified place in that city because the military was there. A gate would open, iron gate would open. We were the only white people. If anybody ever tells me I'm a racist, let me tell you, I am not a racist. Those people protected us, and they treated us in open arms as, you know, COB USA. But we're lucky to be in the USA. I'm telling you, we're very, very lucky. And that's where I've been.
Thank you, sir. And we'll move on to other business.
As previously mentioned in the meeting, the annual town hall meeting will be Monday, 3/6/17, and it will immediately follow the regular council meeting. The council meeting on that Monday will start at 6:30 p.m. and with the town hall to immediately follow after that, and that'll be here at Smith Park Shelter House. Crime Watch meeting will begin again on Wednesday, March the 8th, beginning at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. That's all I got, Mayor.
No.
Okay. Mr. Hammonds.
No. I move that we excuse Mr. Leffley.
Oh, okay.
Oh, second.
Yeah. Oh, there's something else that we need to do.
No, I thought he was going to adjourn. I had something I want to say before.
No. Sorry, I know I normally do it, but no, not this time.
Okay, motion by Mr. Reynolds. Did I hear a second?
Here.
Yes. I'm going to move the first one.
Mr. Lighty.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Graybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Passed 6-0.
Mr. Lowry?
Thank you. All you young people, thank you so much. I know you didn't want to be here. I'm going to give you at least an hour and a half, but I would ask you all to say, town hall meeting coming up. We just heard a lot about it. I don't know if you're paying attention or not. But tell your parents, go home and relate. Something very, very important concerning them, their money, is going to be discussed at the next town hall meeting. And they really need to be. I would request that each one of you do that. Stress the importance to your parents that it is super, super important to be here. Very important. Okay? Please do. Thank you much, and thanks for being here.
Mr. Mayor, move it. Will you adjourn?
Sorry. You're such a hurry. Oh. Is that interesting or what? I mean, we're going to have some interesting seats coming up for council members, so anybody that's 18, you're more than welcome to try and run for council. I know that's probably one of the most entertaining things you've ever seen. So.
Are you ready?
Yes,
Mr. Mayor, move it. We adjourn.